God is good. All the time. I just have one announcement to make. There will be a council meeting tomorrow evening, even for the new members, at 7 o'clock p.m. here at the church, at 7 p.m. Also, the men's group meeting will be postponed or canceled tomorrow evening due to the council meeting. Thank you.
Good morning. Just a reminder, our line site, the pictures from our last line site where we have 21 kids are up in the bulletin board. But just a reminder, our annual fundraiser for our calendars for kids, and David and I are still selling those. These are the wall calendars are $7, and the copy calendars with the notepad are $6, and we appreciate your support. Thank you.
Okay, the altar guild still has many slots open to help with the communion setup and also cleanup. If you've never done it before, don't worry about that. We can teach you how to do it. Mary will help. Other people will help you, and so that you can learn how to do it. It is very easy to do. So thanks to those people that have signed up, but there's still many, many slots left. So please check the table in the back and sign up for altar guild to either set up or to do cleanup or both for the various months that are available. So please check that list in the back. Also, the food pantry. We serve the month of January through the food pantry, and so I need help with that. It's coming up very quickly. And so there are sign-up sheets in the back for that as well. We need people to do phone calling, to take the messages off the answering machine and set up times for the clients to come in. We need food shoppers to go buy the milk and eggs and perishable items each week. And we need food packers. We have several people signed up for that already, so thank you to those people, but we can use more. And I can arrange whatever time's good for you guys. I can meet you there, and we'll open it up so that we can do the food packing. So Tuesdays, Wednesdays, and Thursday, we need people to help with the distribution. And we usually try to start around 2:30, 3 o'clock, and go until like 7. So we need people to help with that, to be there that night to help with the distribution of food for them. So if you have any questions, just check with me, and I can answer this question or what Diane asked, and we'll get that done. So please sign up on those papers in the back. Thank you.
I need a fake. I'm gonna get a couple calendars, and all I have is 100. I'm gonna give the rest to the church today. So what I'm trying to do is get. I'm gonna break it to small ones. Yeah. I don't know how I'm gonna do it, but yeah. So I'm gonna do it now because, well, that works. Now I'll have 24 calendars. This works at the church.
Thank you. Let us pray. Teach us to love.
Love the Lord.
And we will remember to serve the first of all Christ.
All Christ's footsteps.
We may know the love of each other in our lives.
As we prepare our celebration of Jesus' birth, also fill our hearts with love for the world. That all may know the love of the one who has sent, your Son, our Savior.
Amen.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Most merciful God,
we confess that we are in bondage to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen.
Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his only Son to die for us, and for his sake forgives us all our sins. As a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ, and by his authority, I therefore declare unto you the entire forgiveness of all your sins, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Amen. We sing our first hymn together, and it's Remembrance Verses 5 to 8.
Thank you. let us pray to the Lord.
Thank you.
The first reading is from Isaiah. The Lord spoke to Ahaz, saying, "Ask a sign of the Lord your God. Let it be deep as Sheol or high as heaven." But Ahaz said, "I will not ask, and I will not put the Lord to the test." Then Isaiah said, "Hear then, O house of David, is it too little for you to weary mortals, that you weary my God also? Therefore the Lord himself will give you a sign. Look, the young woman is with child and shall bear a son, and shall name him Emmanuel. He shall eat curds and honey by the time he knows how to refuse the evil and choose the good. For before the child knows how to refuse the evil and choose the good, the land before whose two kings you are in dread will be deserted." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We'll read the psalm responsibly. Hear, O shepherd of Israel, leading Joseph like a flock. Shine forth, you that are enthroned upon the cherubim. In the presence of Ephraim, Benjamin, and Manasseh, stir up your strength and come to help us.
Restore us, O God, let your face shine upon us, and we shall be saved. O Lord God of hosts, how long will your hand perfume and your people forever? We have fed them with the bread of tears, and have given them bowls of tears for drink.
You have made us the derision of our neighbors, and our enemies laugh us to scorn. Restore us, O God of hosts, let your face shine upon us, and we shall be saved. Let your hand be upon the one at your right hand, the one you have made so strong for yourself.
And so will we never turn away from you. Give us life, and we may call upon your name. Restore us, O Lord, God of hosts. Let your face shine upon us, and we shall be saved.
Second readings from Romans. Paul, a servant of Jesus Christ, called to be an apostle, set apart for the gospel of God, which he promised beforehand through his prophets in the Holy Scriptures, the gospel concerning his Son, who was descended from David according to the flesh, and was declared to be Son of God with power according to the Spirit of holiness by resurrection from the dead, Jesus Christ our Lord, through whom we have received grace and apostleship to bring about the obedience of faith among all the Gentiles for the sake of his name, including yourselves who are called to belong to Jesus Christ. To all God's beloved in Rome who are called to be saints, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ, the Lord of the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Child from the Holy Spirit, her husband Joseph, being a righteous man and unwilling to expose her to public disgrace, planned to dismiss her quietly. But just when he resolved to do this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, "Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary as your wife, for the child conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will bear a son, and you are to name him Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins." All this took place to fulfill what had been spoken by the Lord through the prophet. "Look, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and they shall name him Emmanuel," which means God is with us. When Joseph awoke from sleep, he did as the angel of the Lord commanded him. He took her as his wife, but had no marital relations with her until she had borne a son, and he named him Jesus. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
You may be seated.
Lord,
morning, Marvin.
Well, good morning, Nancy.
You know, it appears we only have old people here today.
Seems that way.
I know. Well, that's okay, because we love our old people as well as the young people. I invited Everly up, but her mom said, no, 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 she'll tear Bethlehem apart. Okay, we can live with that, and next year she can be up here and enjoy this. But, Marvin, do you ever remember last week when we had a lot of angels, what Angel Jonah brought forward?
I'm sorry, did you repeat that?
Yes. You remember, the reason Marvin's having a problem is that this is no script. This is for kids and this is for the big people. Last week, Angel Jonah led the angels up and he was carrying something. Do you remember what it was?
I don't recall all
of it. Okay, Pastor knows. What was it?
Star.
He was carrying the Star of Bethlehem. Yes, thank you. And pardon? Well, that's true. That's true. He said he's smarter than Moose. Is that true, Debbie? Mostly. Okay, well, good. A few weeks ago, we talked about how we love different things, and if you recall, I asked the kids how much they love broccoli, and there were a couple who said, oh, yeah, and then there were others who were, no. And I asked them how much they like cleaning their room, and they went, cleaning my room? No, 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 no. So then I asked them about pizza, and they went, oh, yeah, yeah, we like pizza. Well, how about your parents? Yeah, yeah, they like those too. And I said, well, there is someone who loves you this much. And how do we know that? Well, we know that it was Jesus, because he was hung on a cross, and his arms were spread to save us. Well, if you will notice, in the middle of the Bethlehem Star, there is a cross. And even at his birth, the stars and planets, or the star, however you want to think of that, came together, foretold of his saving us from our sins, even at his birth. Now, at this point, we were going to go on and talk about wise men, but they don't really come until Epiphany. And since I don't have any little ones, we're going to save our wise men until January 8th. So you have to come back then to help us finish our nativity scene. So thank you. Mary, would you click? I'm sorry, you got up. I was going to walk over and give the pastor my mic so we can hear his sermon. Play, What Can I Give Him?
Assyrians, commanded by Tiglath-Pileser III,
And this way, he states, Israel and Syria among them paid tribute to Assyria. It was highly unpopular because the tribute was raised by levying heavy taxes on the people. You kind of know what that's like, right? When taxes get more and more, and it's harder and harder to make ends meet and all that kind of stuff. That's not new to our era. That's happened all through human history, where governments have had the ability to call heavy taxes. They always seem to want more than less. I don't know how that works, but that's the way it was under Big Nebuchadnezzar as well. In tax revolt, 8th century BC style, an Israelite army captain by the name of Pekah murdered Israel's king and the king's son. He wrested control of the throne and entered into an anti-Assyrian coalition with Syria. The coalition's first move was to march south and to take over Judah, because essentially King Ahab was not in the mood to join their coalition. So they were going to come down and whack him and take over him, put a puppet king on Judah's throne so they could flesh out, if you will, their contingent of people who would go against Assyria. King Ahaz was in a tight spot. He had ascended the throne of Judah in one of Judah's greatest hours. It's not difficult for us to sympathize with Ahaz and his political situation. The presence of an invading army on your soil filled him with panic. The scripture states his heart and the hearts of his people shook like trees of the forest, shaken by the wind. Terror seized Ahaz. And he sacrificed, you might remember this from your Old Testament study, he sacrificed his son in the Valley of Hinnom, hoping that the gods, notice he wasn't doing that to Yahweh, to the God of Israel, but he sacrificed hoping that this would alleviate the gods and would get them on his side, and somehow he could invoke their help. That wasn't going to work, but from that time, the Valley of Hinnom became a place, it became the trash dump in Jesus' day. They wouldn't use that area for anything else because of that kind of sacrifice, that child sacrifice that had taken place. But it tells you how dire the king felt, that he had to have some kind of leverage spiritually to save his city. Ahaz, as a responsible political leader, had decided it was better then to accept the defeat at the hands of the invaders and not to ask for help. But he began to think to himself, maybe the enemy of my enemy is my friend. You know how that goes? And so he began to contemplate that maybe the thing to do was to go over to the Assyrians and gain their help against Israel in Syria. And that's exactly what he was contemplating to do. And in the midst of why he's pondering that, canoodling upon it, here comes Isaiah into his midst. And Isaiah comes and he brings a little child with him. And the child's name was A Remnant Shall Return. And this child was a classic sign child. A remnant shall return. Ahaz, harassed and worried, does not heed the prophet's voice. Isaiah's message to the king is simple. Perhaps it was too simple. It was simply, trust Yahweh, be quiet, and keep calm. The appropriate response to the crisis, Isaiah said, is faith. The weak alliance between Israel and Syria would not succeed unless Yahweh, the God of Israel, allowed it. Isaiah said, using a play on words, if your faith is not sure, your throne will not be secure. Abandon human allegiance and place your reliance on Yahweh, whose sovereign will controls human affairs. Such faith demanded the complete and firm commitment of our whole being in God, trusting that Yahweh is the true king. But Ahaz wasn't able to trust in this way. He planned instead to plead for assistance from Assyria. Isaiah offers on God's behalf a sign, but the king refuses, ostensibly as a pious gesture. For Israel had long known the command, do not put the Lord your God to the test. That's in Deuteronomy 6:16. In fact, however, the king's refusal to join a conversation in which the demand of faith may become established is valid
was not something that the king wanted to do. If the king finds out that the prophetic word is true, then he will be obliged to revise his foreign policy and to conform to the assurance of faith. He's going to have to trust God instead of his own intellect, instead of his own political sensibilities. And that he simply does not want to do. So what is first seen and appears to be an act of profound faith on the part of the king is really a clever act of evasion. King Ahaz has no intention of submitting himself to the Lord's policies, to the claims of faith, because he prefers his own authority rather than faith. Ahaz's clever but stubborn refusal evokes from the prophet a hard, devastating oracle. Isaiah puts the royal house on notice. In addition, Isaiah now refers to Yahweh as my God. By implication, this odd pronoun suggests that Yahweh is no longer your God. His hand of providence has now been lifted from the nation, withdrawn from the dynasty. The dynasty wanted autonomy, and now it has it. What have I said to you over and over again? The worst thing you want to hear from God is, okay, your will be done. You don't want my will to be done in your life? Fine, your will be done. You never want Yahweh, the God of all creation, to say that to you. Because you are in the tall weeds at that point. I'm telling you, it's bad juju. And that's exactly what he said to Judah and to King Ahaz. Okay, you don't want my will? Then your will be done. So I'm going to turn out well for you. And his hand of providence was lifted off of that dynasty. And yet, God gives Ahaz a sign from Isaiah's lips. He said, behold, a young woman shall conceive and bear a son, and his name shall be called Emmanuel. Emmanuel, God with us. Really, if you break it down, Em would be with. El at the end is God. In the middle, it's us. The word is us. So, with us, God, or God with us. Literally, that's what Emmanuel means. Did you think King Ahaz and Israel and Syria were going to be your greatest threats? No. I tell you, by the time the child is 2 years of age, that is, by the time he knows how to refuse the evil and choose the good, the two powers that you fear will be no more. Of course, Assyria was not even on the radar screen of King Ahaz at this point as being a real enemy and threat, becomes a far greater threat to Judah. But God did not send Isaiah simply to adjudicate for the king what is a small threat from a bigger threat, a large threat. For the king could have figured that out eventually on his own. Rather, the prophet seeks to gather every facet of life, both public and private, and reorganize it around the baby whose name is God with us. Asserts the certainty of God in all of life, therefore. Or another way of saying it is, this baby, God with us, becomes for us the lens through which we see, observe, experience every facet of human existence. And because of this, everything now has become new. That's why in the New Testament, in Christ Jesus, everything is made new. Behold, the old is past. You can't live the same life you lived before Jesus. You can't do it, Paul says, because you're dead, buried, and out of the way of your baptism. Everything has become new. You're a new creature in Christ Jesus. And Paul says you can't enter the kingdom of heaven living the old life. If you want to enter by Jesus, you have to enter as a new creature. Jesus said, born from above, born of water and the Word, the sign of our conversion, if you will, to being in Christ Jesus, to accepting his love, mercy, forgiveness, and grace, his blood on the cross. Someone said, if you follow the navel star, it leads to the cross. From the cross to the crown, from the cross to the grave, from the cross, from the star to the cross of Jesus. Open arms, bled out for you and me. All that jazz about the temple sacrifices, those were only temporary coverings of blood. They weren't forever. As soon as you confess your sins, as soon as you sacrifice the lamb on the altar, your sins began to accrue again, and you had to come back and over again, take a blood sacrifice for the covering of your sins, But when Jesus died, his blood was a forever covenant. What do we say in the institution of Holy Communion? Jesus said, this is the cup of the new covenant. It's my blood shed for you. It's an everlasting covenant given and shed for you. Do this for the remembrance of me. And it is and was, even unto this day. It's God's grace lived out in action. Well, Assyria became a great adversary of Judah and destroyed them and took them away in 721 B.C., the north, and in 587 came around back and took all of Judah into Assyrian, by that time they were beat by the Babylonians and taken into Babylonian captivity because they never, ever got it. They never, ever, in that moment of time in human history, understood the gift that God was giving them and the trust that he asked them to live in. Basically, you can do it my way, God says, or you can do it your way. And it's easy to understand that when we come full circle and see the text before us in the Gospel of Matthew, why Matthew reaches back to this ancient prophecy of Isaiah and says in Jesus, God is fulfilling that prophecy anew. He did fulfill it. He did fulfill that in the Old Testament. But now he picks up the prophecy and reinvigorates it and reconstitutes it and now fulfills it anew. Only this time more completely, more fully. For now the child is God's own son, given not just for the faithless king, but given to all us faithless ones. Given to all of us who are terror-stricken, terrorized, unhappy, troubled, proud, guilt-ridden ones. The sad truth is we who would like to believe, we would recognize God if we saw him, are more like those who did see God in Jesus and failed to recognize the time of their visitation. It's human nature to want to do it our way. It's human nature to want to come back to God and make it all right on our own. But it never works out that way. Nevertheless, it is for us, whether in the midst of crisis or peace, whether we are depressed or full of hope, to all those who with weak hands and shaky knees, the sign is given. Accepted or not accepted, it is given. A simple sign, to be sure, perhaps too simple. A sign which evokes faith in some and ridicule in others. And we've seen that, haven't we? We've seen places that on the lawn, you know, on the courthouse lawn, they put up the crash, and then somebody comes along who's an atheist who hates God, and they put up an atheist memorial in the same place. Some people will believe and have faith, and some people's faith is in nothing at all. So we can accept or ridicule, but the sign is still given. And the sign is to us a child is born. To us a son is given. Is God's living pledge that God is not only with us, God is among us, in our hearts, upon the altar, in the font, in with and under the need of our neighbors. To those who have eyes to see, the Son's presence will be a sign, an assurance from God that God is redeeming his people. He is leading his people through the divine fire of judgment to the dawn of a new day. The Son of God shares the suffering of his people, even drinking with us the bitter cup of death. We may wonder, why do bad things happen to us? I don't know. We live in a broken world where very wonderful people come down with crummy, lousy, rotten diseases, and little children die of cancer, and all of the rest. But we also worship a God who came into the midst of the mess, made the journey with us, and allowed humanity to kill him. And he went to the cross like a lamb silent before its shears, and allowed humanity to do the very worst thing we could do is reject him. And yet he turns around and said, if you can believe it, if you can trust me, if you accept it, my blood redeems you and makes you whole in relationship with your Father in heaven forever. Yes, you're going to die unless I come again in the interim. We will all die. One nurse told me we all die of cardiac arrest. No matter what your disease is, finally at some point your heart stops. If you have cancer, if you have a stroke, it doesn't matter. Heart attack, when your heart stops, you die. We all die of cardiac arrest. And by God's grace, those in Christ Jesus who hold to be with the Father, new and young forever. All I know is the Father and the Son and the Spirit make their journey with us. What he promises us is not that nothing bad will happen to us. We could all write letters to God and Christmas cards to God, how we want our health to be better, how we want our lives to be better, how we make more money, and all the rest, have more time to enjoy our grandchildren, whatever it is, we can write the letter. The Lord God never said that he has a magic wand and will make it all better in this life. He never promised you that. What he promised you that is, I will walk with you in the midst of the mess, and I will never ever abandon you, even in your darkest hour. Psalm 23, yea, though I walk through the valley of death, I will fear no evil. Hey, it didn't say, God's going to free me from walking through the valley of the shadow of death. He says, yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I'll fear no evil. Why? Your rod and your staff, you shepherd, God will be with me. That's why I have confidence walking even into the face of death, because I know that I have eternal life already. And by the Lamb's blood, my name has been written in the Lamb's book of life. And nothing has the power to erase that. Except perhaps my unfaith and telling God I don't want it and I'm going to walk away from it. Nothing in this world can separate me from the love of God in Christ Jesus. Jesus, Emmanuel, God with us, who has come down to be with and among us, abides with us still because the crucified one is also the risen one. Risen to reign in our hearts by faith and to dwell in our spirits by virtue of the Holy Spirit's presence within us. And like God's people of old, it will only be after the child ascends the throne and the consummation of human history that we will fully understand the sign and how the child has been God with us. Then and only then will the meaning of Emmanuel be fully comprehended, fully known, and fully understood. For now, we walk as King, and as God bid King Ahaz to walk, by faith, and not by sight. Trusting, taking your dad's hand, and just following him. Amen.
As we sing the hymn of the day, I'd like to draw your attention to, we will only be singing verse 2. Let all mortal flesh keep silence. Verse 2.
He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
As we await the coming of our Savior in mercy and majesty, let us pray to his Father for the church, the world, and for all people according to their need. O wisdom, proceeding from the mouth of the Most High, fill the church with your Spirit. Sustain and order its proclamation and its works of charity, especially in the presence of our enemies, according to your most holy will. Come and teach us prudence. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
O Adonai, ruler of the house of Israel, rule also in our hearts, lives, and ministry of your people in this congregation. Give us your word and show us your glory. Look with favor upon our sister congregations and your missionaries around the world. Come with our outstretched arm to redeem us. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
O Emmanuel, the ransom of your people Israel, deliver also your persecuted church from captivity and torment. Keep it patient, faithful, and steadfast. Help us to honor their witness and provide for their needs, and turn their tormentors from their evil ways. Come and teach them courage. Lord, in your mercy. O bright and morning star, you gladden the hearts of those who sit in darkness. Shine upon all who are overwhelmed by grief, despair, doubt, anger, confusion, hatred, or unbelief. Come and lead them to the brightness of your holy love. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayers.
O King of the nations, the ruler they long for, unite all people under your glorious and gentle reign. Teach us those things that make for peace. Come and save us all, whom you formed out of clay. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
O root of Jesse, you stand as an ensign to the peoples. Guard and guide all who stand in harm's way in defense of justice and freedom. Come quickly and deliver them. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
O key of David, you open what no one else can close. You close what no one can open. Free those imprisoned by the powers of sin, evil, and death. We lift before your throne of grace our homebound, our church family and friends in need of healing, strength, and comfort. Those named in our bulletin, on our prayer chain, and those who we name aloud or in the quiet of our own hearts. Come and close the path to misery. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
O day spring, splendor of life everlasting, keep safe in your mighty arms all those who die trusting in your promises. Come and enlighten us, who will sit in the shadow of death and open wide our heavenly home. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
In your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
I invite you to share Christ's own peace one with another.
That's peace, David. That's peace.
Peace be with you.
to the peace player, he's going to make God's peace be seen on you.
Praise your name and join their unending hymn.
Glory, 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 Lord.
Lord Jesus Christ was betrayed, we remember how he took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, and after giving thanks, he gave it for all of them to drink, saying, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this for the remembrance of me." Together we pray,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Please stand with me. The body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and give you in his grace. Amen.
Let us pray. Almighty God, you gave your Son both as a sacrifice for sin and a model of the godly life. Enable us to receive him always with thanksgiving and to conform our lives to his through the same Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with favor and grant you peace. Amen.
Go with the love of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.